What does the perfect data science setup look like? I'm talking something that'll speed up your productivity, let you code faster and more efficiently. Well, there might not be a perfect setup, but I'm gonna walk you through today what I use on a daily basis for doing data science projects. I'm gonna break this down into a few different parts, so let's go at it first by talking about operating system. Now, the operating system I have set up on my machine, and I use this about 90% of the time on my personal machines, is Linux, and the personal favorite flavor of Linux is Ubuntu. The main reason why I use Ubuntu is because it's the most popular version of Linux out there. Because of that, things are usually up to date and I don't have to worry about bugs being introduced into my operating system. And I would say my second favorite operating system is just the Mac OS. I use Macs for work a lot of the time and it's Unix based, so it's gonna be very similar to Linux. That being said, I do have dual boot set up on my computer, so I sometimes we'll load it up in Windows. And the reason why is because it used to be that any gaming that I'd want to do, Windows was sort of the only way to do it, and Linux, the games wouldn't load. Now recently, especially with games like Elden Ring, they've been working better in Linux than Windows. So I actually haven't booted up Windows in years. I also don't game as much as I used to. The reason why I like running Linux for data science is because most of the work you're gonna be doing is on a server, in the cloud server, or if you wanna set up your home server, Linux is the main operating system that everything runs on. And if your main PC is running on it, then it's just gonna be super easy to transition over to what other stuff that you're gonna work on. Also, it boots up super fast, it's very clean, and there's none of that bloatware there. I remember when Windows added to their start menu all the news feed and stuff that you don't really necessarily always want. You don't have any of that junk. Another reason why I really like using Linux is you can do so much just in the command line. When you install packages, you can just sudo apt update and it'll go look for the updates to any packages you have on your machine, any drivers, and then you can sudo apt upgrade to upgrade them. And you're working with code and data science, the fact that you can just reproduce things in your operating system by running lines of code that you might find in Stack Overflow or in other solutions is so much more powerful than clicking and moving things around. And also sort of on that note, a big thing about having a Linux backend is that you're running bash. Let's say I wanted to go to a directory and move files around. There's no reason to open up an explorer to select things and to actually drag them into folders. If you get good at it, you can move files around using command line like mv for move or cp for copying files. It sounds like a little thing, but being comfortable using bash and being able to move files around like that is such a time saver and something you should definitely look into mastering. Maybe I'll make another video on that. Another reason why I love using Linux is because if my laptop or a second desktop machine that I have, I can easily SSH into that. SSHing lets you connect to your other computer and basically interact with it in the command line as if you were on that other machine. You can also forward ports, so you could say run JupyterLab on your desktop computer and SSH to it from a laptop, and voila, you're running Python on your other computer, but you're being able to interact with it through a web browser on your laptop. The next thing I'd like to talk about is how I interact with the terminal. So I am using Mate Terminal. I also have a solarized dark theme. That's just my preference here. So you can go into profiles and set up in your terminal what the colors look like. But the main and most powerful thing that I use when I am interacting with the terminal is something called Tmux. So I actually have a alias called Robmux. And when I run that, it'll start a new session of Tmux. Now, Tmux is just something that's running on your machine that keeps the state of your terminal. So any of the windows or the processes that you have running, if you're not in Tmux and you're running, let's say, a Python script and you X out, it will shut down that session or whatever you're running. However, if you're in Tmux and you're running something like list everything in this directory and I close out of this, The next time that I go into Tmux, I'm right back where I left off. So that's one of the main reasons why running Tmux is great. You can also see that Tmux has some stuff down here on the bottom, how long my machine has been up for, what I am actually running here is bash, a clock, what I've named this machine. So if I've SSH'd into a different machine, that will change. And I have all of this set up in my Tmux config file. So this is where you can configure Tmux to look really fancy and beautiful. I have a few custom things set up, but most of my Tmux settings I've gotten from other people out there who have really perfected this art. So I actually copied my base configuration file from this GitHub repo, which I'll also link in the description. It's what I use to get this pretty bar at the bottom. And I even have in my own GitHub repo my exact Tmux settings, so that if I go onto another server and I want to run Tmux exactly like I'm used to on my home PC, I can clone that repo, copy in the Tmux configuration file. Now, some other things that make Tmux awesome is that with some simple command line shortcuts, you can actually split panes and be running multiple different terminal sessions at the same time. The reason why this is great is because you can, let's say, run a Python script in the top right here, and then on the left side, you can tail maybe a log file, if there's a log file, in the exact same windows. And like I said, if this closes down, you load it back up, you're in the exact same spot. You can also add tabs, so Control B and T will make a second tab down here. You see how there are two numbers? Switch between them. I use Shift and the arrow keys. Everything in Tmux has a ton of keyboard shortcuts that you just need to learn. And even if you're, say, running on a Windows machine, chances are in data science, you're gonna be SSHing into a server where you're gonna wanna run Tmux, especially then, because if you lose connection to that machine because of a bad internet connection, you want Tmux to keep that session up. Did I mention I like Tmux? I think I've mentioned that enough. Now, a few other things about my terminal I'll just mention is when you're running bash, you can set up aliases that can be really helpful. So I have a lot of aliases that I use. One of them you'll notice that I use a lot, which is LC, and that's just listing all the files. It's actually ls-flash color, but I don't want to run that every time. So the alias just lets me set up a short command that I can run, and then it'll run the long command. Aliases, really good. Make sure you set those up. Now, two other quick things that I use all the time when I'm in my terminal. One is htop. This basically lets you see all the processes running on your computer. So this is like a system profiler of everything running on your machine. So all my cores, amount of memory that's being used. As a data scientist, you might be pushing the limits of your machine so that you might have too much data for memory and you need to keep an eye on the memory. HTOP is great for that. There's also BTOP, which has a little bit of a different look and feel to it. I haven't really bought into it, but I know some people swear by it. And of course, for all you old school people out there, you can just run the straight old school top and avoid any of the colors and stuff. But HTOP's my fave. Another thing similar to HTOP is NVTOP. NVTOP lets you see the processes being run on your GPU. So if you have a machine that has a GPU and you're gonna be doing stuff like deep learning, this is great because you can see how much memory and how much CPU is being used on each of your devices or on your GPU. And I usually have a tab open with NVTOP and a tab open with HTOP in my Tmux, just so I can jump to this if I ever need to. All right, next let's talk about package managers. I know there are a lot of different options out there for keeping different environments in Python or whatever project you're working on separate, because maybe you want a version of Pandas that's older for one project, but you're gonna use a newer version for a different project. I personally use Anaconda and Conda to manage my environments, and I use pip to install my Python packages. I don't use Conda to install Python packages anymore. It has that ability, but I mainly just use it to containerize my environments. Usually when people are teaching how to get started with Python on your computer, they recommend installing Anaconda. All Anaconda is a pre-packaged version of Conda with all of the main packages used for data science. So I too would recommend using Anaconda as your main thing that you install. If you're trying to run Python and data science on your computer, Miniconda is just more of a lightweight version of Anaconda where you can just get the essential packages needed to run some Python stuff on your local machine. So you can tell I have Conda installed on this machine because all the way to the left of my terminal here, it says base. That means I'm in my base Conda environment. And I can just run Conda with the Conda command, and env list will list all my environments that I have. So over the years, I've kind of gotten a few of these different Conda environments for different projects that I've been working on. And you can create these using Conda create. You could tell it a version of Python that you want. It's just great because it'll keep everything isolated. So if I wanted to say activate Kaggle 2, then if I type in which Python, we can see that my main Python now is directed to my Kaggle 2, which is the second Kaggle environment that I made on my machine because the first one broke. So there's really great documentation about how to manage your environments in Conda and activating them, adding new ones, deleting them. I've spent a lot of time on this page learning how to set up my environments, and I'd recommend you do too. Now in my environment, I can do Conda list. This will list all the packages that I have installed. Conda will let you install more than just Python packages. Pip is what I use to install Python packages once I'm in my environment. Usually I've found pip to be less buggy than Conda, and it does a really good job of managing dependencies and all the stuff that goes along with. Of course, you could go the Docker route, but I've managed to avoid that for a lot of reasons, except for productionized code that you have to deploy, and mainly that's in my work environment. And of course, installing things with pip is pretty easy. In the command line, you just do pip install, let's say pandas. Says I already have it installed. I could do something like upgrade, and it's gonna download the latest version and uninstall my old version, take care of all the dependencies. You must learn how to use pip if you're working in Python. Now let's talk about IDEs. IDE is basically the software that you use to write your code. Now, I'm not very strict about only using one IDE for one thing. I actually like to use many different IDEs for different things. The main one that I would definitely recommend getting at least useful with opening up a file and being able to do some simple edits with, because it's the least intuitive, is Vim or VI. So if you have Vim installed in Linux, you can just load it up by typing in Vim. It'll bring you into this editor. I use Vim a lot when I'm logging into a remote machine and I want to edit a file, do some quick changes, or I'm working on code that's already established and I'm just doing debugging. Learning the key bindings in Vim can make your life a lot easier, and really just things like being able to jump around, do quick edits. And if I was a real hardcore coder making production code all day, I might even say use Vim as your main IDE because it really is that powerful. I also really like using Sublime Text. I mainly use Sublime Text for code snippets or making to-do lists, honestly. And I can load up Sublime Text here. I find myself using Sublime Text to write a lot of SQL queries, which then I'll execute in other code. So there is an extension that I use a lot called SQL Beautifier that will just take nasty looking SQL code and you can just run it here and it makes it a lot easier to read. But I'm not gonna lie, most of the code that I write as a data scientist is in Jupyter Lab. And I have a whole video talking about Jupyter, Jupyter Notebooks, Jupyter Lab, but I'm just gonna show you basically why I use Jupyter Lab. It's because I feel like the environment's really easy to navigate, code looks nice, and most of the time, the code that I'm writing isn't production code. It's more exploratory. I'm looking at data for the first time. I don't know exactly what I'm gonna write, and jumping from cell to cell is really important and being able to be efficient. That's why I'd suggest checking out my tips and tricks section of my Jupyter Lab video if you want to learn more about that. There comes a time though when running a Jupyter notebook is just not the right place to be writing code. And when you want to abstract that code out and work on it, usually the editor that I use is VS Code. So I'll show you just an example here. Here's my VS Code. I've written a few functions. Let's say I still want to use these in a notebook to interact with some data that I've written. The nice thing is I usually keep these in a separate folder, a source code folder, right next to my notebooks. And then over here in my notebook, you can see that I'm actually importing from this scripts file into my notebook. So a lot of the code that's abstracted out, I will then edit in VS Code just because it's a great IDE in general, it's lightweight, and it is the most popular one out there. Now, I know some people might say you can run notebooks in VS Code, and I know that's the case, but I've tried it and I don't like it as much as the Jupyter Lab environment. I find things to be smoother, and especially the keyboard commands that I use so frequently, I haven't been able to switch over to VS Code and have the same feel as I do working with Jupyter Lab. But that's just me. I like using Git in the command line. It just, I find that's the easiest way to track and commit all my changes. I also like to write a lot of code in Kaggle notebooks. That's because, mainly because I can share it with you all and you can easily spin up your own environment by copying these notebooks. It's also kind of like a public portfolio where you can share all of your code that you've written. And then most of the things that I've mentioned, when I'm working on a remote machine, I can run all these things, VS Code, Jupyter Lab, I have Conda installed, have it all set up the way I want, and then I'm just forwarding everything over through SSH to my local machine. You don't necessarily need to have a beefy machine to do data science because you can always connect remotely to larger machines and spin them up as you need. There you go. I hope you found this video helpful, maybe showed you a few things that you didn't know about that you can try to either look into or start using in your data science workflow. I often get asked the question about how I set things up, so this is the way I currently use it. It might change down the road as new things come out. I find myself changing and adapting to them. So if there's anything specific that I mentioned in this video that you want me to do a deeper dive into, let me know in the comments below. Give me a like, subscribe. That's the best way you can support me, and it's completely free. So hopefully you will do that. And I'll see you in the next video.